The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest episode of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by one of the greatest pro wrestlers the world has never seen, Mr. News himself, co-owner of Discovery Wrestling, Alan Smith. Welcome to the show.
That is one hell of an intro. One of the greatest wrestlers that the world has never seen. You're right. You're right. You're absolutely right. I can't argue with that intro.
How's it going? I know I've asked you this off the pod, but this is the recording bit now.
Yeah, no, I'm good. I'm just, I'm with a day job. I'm a reporter for radio and a lot of radio stations across Scotland, and I specialise in politics. And there's an election going on just now, so I am out and about every single day, going across Scotland, speaking to political leaders every day right now. And for a lot of people, they might find that boring, but for me, like everyone else, I've been working at home for the past year. So the chance actually to get out and about, get back in the car, listen to some music, because I love driving. It's been great the last few weeks. I've really enjoyed just getting out and about in the country again. So, yeah, I'm good. I'm in a good spot right now.
Wrestling and politics. There's a combination you never get.
Yeah. It would amaze you that the number of politicians who are closet wrestling fans.
Absolutely. Especially when you see promos.
The first day in my new role in politics, and I'm based at the Scottish Parliament, and I went into the Scottish Parliament and I was walking through what they call the garden lobby, which is where everybody kind of meets or has a coffee or whatever, and they'll remain nameless, but one of the party leaders at that time, and this is 2016, was just walking through the garden lobby, and I thought, I'll stop them, introduce myself, say hey, just so they know who I am and I'm about. And I stopped them and they went, oh, hey, you're the wrestler, right? And it turns out that a couple of the Sunday newspapers had picked up on this former wrestler who was joining the Holyrood lobby and wrote articles. And it was in the Sunday papers about how this former wrestler was going to be getting to grips when grappling with the politicians. So a lot of the politicians already know about my past and what I do, and a lot of them love it, and a lot of them kind of come out as wrestling fans to me, and then just it's just insane at times, just the kind of crossover of it all.
Absolutely, it must be nice. It also gets your kind of your foot in with them. It's like, oh, we both like wrestling, then it can lead to it's icebreaker, I suppose, when it comes to
yeah. I've tried to shoo in some wrestling chat during the election campaign. I asked Anna Sarwar, Labour leader, about because his brother's a massive wrestling fan and goes to WWE events when they come to Scotland. So I asked him about his because he was asking me about WrestleMania this year and who won. He was like, "Who won? Did Drew win or did Bobby win?" And this is one of the party leaders asking me this, and so I asked him his favorite WrestleMania was Hogan versus Warrior. And I asked, I had a bit of chat with Douglas Ross, the Scottish Tory leader, about wrestling. And he says his knowledge of wrestling doesn't go past giant haystacks. So they're trying to shoehorn any wrestling chat into the selection campaign just to keep me sane.
Okay, we do. We won't go into politics because we all have opinions, and I don't want anyone to really shout down at me for having one opinion or the other. I think we're on edge as it is with wrestling, as it is, let alone throwing in some actual politics that changes the world into it. Right. So, for those that are unaware that are listening to this and watching this, we've actually known each other for quite a long time since what was it, 2013, I think. February 2013 is when I first actually met yourself backstage at a show. So it's been a yeah. long journey for both of us.
And we're clearly share the same hairstylist, and look, the bald head, bearded glasses look.
It's the fashion.
Yeah.
But the first question is always the same, although I don't think I've asked questions so far. So it's the first one. How did you get into pro wrestling and what got you hooked?
Well, what got me hooked, first of all, was being around, must have been about six, seven years old. And the family had just got Sky Television, when Sky Television had just become a thing. And me and my older brother were flicking through the channels, and we got onto a channel, and there was Hulk Hogan on the television doing a promo. And I'd never watched wrestling before in my life, but yet somehow me and my brother recognised Hulk Hogan. We'd seen this guy before somewhere. So we stopped and went, oh, there's that guy. And we didn't know what it was. We didn't know what he was talking about. And then it cut to a promo with the Ultimate Warrior. And then we were hooked. We were just like, this is madness. This is just the best thing we'd ever seen. So that kind of brought me into it. And I remember going to my first ever live wrestling event in Forfar, because that's where we grew up, the Retail in Forfar. And the main attraction was Giant Haystacks. And me and some young friends were in the Retail in Forfar, front row, and here comes Giant Haystacks walking around the ring, and he's got this massive rope as a belt, you know, and us being young kids as we are, just start shouting at him, like, you're fat, you know. It was the late 80s, and, you know, we were just shouting at him that he was fat. Clearly he knows he's a big fella because he uses a rope for a belt. But then he just stopped and he spat on us all. He just stopped and proper gobbed on us all. And it's a pretty strange way to get hooked into wrestling, but that was it for me. It still stands out in my mind. It's like my first experience of live wrestling. So that's what kind of pulled me in terms of how I got involved in wrestling. As I've said, you know, working in radio, and I was working in Dundee at the time, and the local promoter had approached the station and said, look, we've got a massive event coming up. We need, you know, how can we get talked about? And our breakfast presenter knew I was a big wrestling fan and said, you know what, if you train him up and put him in a match, we'll talk about it. So hence why I got the name Mr. News, because that was my nickname on the breakfast show. For being their news shooter, they called me Mr. News, and that's where the wrestling name came from. And that's how it started. You know, it was only ever supposed to be one match. You know, I did a couple of months of training, then I was on this big show that they had, and I got such a buzz off doing it that I stuck with it. And I think, 12, 13 years on, here I am. I'm now doing my own shows in Edinburgh.
So when I first saw you, actually, so I first met you in 2013, but I first saw you at my first wrestling show outside of WWE and tribute shows, because everyone loves them, was a cage match. And you were teaming with Randy Valentine as the Mega Pals.
Yeah.
So how did that tag team come about?
Well, the Mega Pals, basically, you know, I'd only had a couple of matches at that point, and Randy had been around and had made a request. He'd seen me come in, and it was his idea. He said, I want to team with him, you know. And I thought, you know, pretty cool. This guy who's been about a bit wants to, you know, team with me and kind of show me the ropes a wee bit. And so he wanted to do that, and he had this idea of being kind of, I guess, our version of the Mega Powers, and became the Mega Pals, and that's where it all kind of stemmed from. And we just, you know, I didn't know Randy before he made that request to team with me, and it was only through that we, you know, we became really good pals and hung out and, you know, talked ideas a lot, and we're kind of similar senses of humor as well. So, you know, there's a lot of the promos that we did, a lot of the video promos we did, they were just hysterical to film. You know, whether it was just funny to us or whether it was funny to other people, you know, we had a good time doing it. And so that's how the Mega Pals came about. And we had a blast. And to this day, he's still my Mega Pal. You know, he's a commentator with us at Discovery. He's a massive input into the ideas that we have for Discovery and what we do. He plays just such a huge role. So it's just amazing where you meet people and where it takes you. So, yeah, we're still Mega Pals to this day.
It's good to hear. So yeah, about your time in Dundee, I've written down a couple. I'm not a writer. As I wrote down some just memorable moments for myself. One is when you're the champion, and there was a show that sold out on a Wednesday night, where you end up getting diamond cuttered by Diamond Dallas Page.
Yeah.
which also involved one of my favourite finishes to a wrestling match with, between yourself and Sam Ross. But what was it like, interacting with DDP? Did he pull you aside before or after to talk about your wrestling? What was it like?
Well, DDP was very cool. Like, we had him with us for a week, and he was very, you know, he was just really sound. You know, in terms of the event itself, you know, a lot of times when you bring, you know, international wrestlers in, you know, they just worry about their own business and what they're doing on that night and whatever else. But he sat and watched the entire show from the balcony through a curtain. And he was watching the matches, and when people were coming back upstairs, he was giving people feedback, which, you know, is priceless for a wrestler. If you've got someone like DDP watching your match, someone who's done it, you know, as you come back up the stairs and he says, I like this, you could do more of this. You know, it was very, 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 very cool. You know, we did a promo with him, and then we did the spot with him where, you know, the whole kind of promo was about how, you know, I was the champion there, and, you know, he was the guest and he needed to shake my hand and show me a bit of respect. So that was kind of going on the entire show. And we got to the end of the show, and when he finally did come out, when I was in the ring, and we did the shake the hand thing, and then he just dropped me with a cutter. And yeah, it was just very cool, you know, and you know, he gave a lot of feedback to me afterwards as well. And it was just sound, because you know what they say about kind of never meeting your heroes, because you just never know how they're going to turn out. But he was really cool. I think everyone enjoyed him being there. And yeah, you know, he did a big DDP yoga session in Dundee with us all as well. So yeah, he was just class. He was a class act.
Yeah, I remember that show, of course, because I was there. I think I actually got a little video of you getting diamond cuttered as well, but it was recorded on like the very oldest of tech, so it's not very clear. But I was also victim of the first of probably many in my life in the future of a Mr. News photobomb.
God.
Your smiley wee face between me and DDP.
Sometimes I feel bad about that when the photos go up, and I think, God, you know, these people queued and paid to get the photo, and then if you zoom and zoom and zoom and zoom into the photo, there's just my round smiling, grinning face in the background, and I think I feel bad about it for a second, and then I laugh because I'm a child and I find it funny. So I apologize, because there's so many times it's happened as well. There's so many times it's happened.
And, but every time I look at the photo, I just think, oh, I'm a mean D. There he is, right in the middle of both of us. And then it just makes me laugh again. It makes me remember the times that I was down Dundee for shows. So it was, it's always good. Again, another match I wanted to bring up, and then we'll move on to Discovery, what have you, is your triple threat at the Bonner Hall. It was against Dave and Johnny Lyons. I brought it up because there was a line through the whole show that you were trying to get out of the match with a injured wrist, and you were trying to get hold of Ted DiBiase, who was at the show.
Yeah.
So again, Ted was obviously down Dundee quite often, maybe twice a year, once or twice a year at that point. You said never meet your heroes. What was it like doing a promo and a skit with Ted DiBiase?
I did a couple with Ted. I did one right after that cage match you spoke about in Perth, and there was a promo that went up after that as well, but then we did the Finding Ted series, because you know, I had a wrist injury at that time. I'd fractured I'd chipped a bone in my wrist with there was a match involving American footballers, and they lobbed me back over the barriers and I landed on the deck and hurt my wrist. So I was trying to find a way of getting out the match. And so we did a series called Finding Ted, Randy and myself. And it was just ridiculous. You know, it was just these stupid videos going up on YouTube, you know, trying to Facebook Ted, trying to like send a message in a bottle, all this just to try and get out of a match, you know. And then he was there on show day, and we filmed something very, very quick with him where, you know, I was pleading with him to get out of the match, and, you know, just a classic Ted playing the world's smallest violin, and, you know, all this kind of stuff, and then just sent me on my way out to the match. And he was very cool. He was very down with anything we wanted to do, really. so he was another class act when he came across. I think everyone enjoyed him being there.
Okay, great stuff. So before I get to Discovery, there's a picture that comes into my mind. Did you have an interview with Jeff Jarrett that ended with him? There's a still picture
grabbing me by the throat.
Yeah, that's the one. How did that come about?
So this was part of the breakfast show. It was part of, and TNA were in Glasgow. So the kind of, I guess the story behind it was, you know, the Breakfast Presenter sent me a challenge to sneak into the show and see if I can grab interviews, you know. But clearly the interviews had already been arranged, but it was all kind of, you know, it was all just kind of set up for a bit of kind of radio fun where, you know, I'm supposedly sneaking backstage around, you know, the TNA show, and then I bump into Jeff Jarrett and I try and grab an interview with him, and grabs me by the throat and throws me out. So that was the photo that that you sometimes see is Jeff Jarrett just grabbing me by the throat, as you do.
So you've kind of, before you even started your own promotion, you've been around some of the biggest names in pro wrestling at this point. What made you decide to start? So it was yourself and Alex Fowlis over a cup of tea, if I remember rightly, from an interview you've done a long time ago. But what made you decide to actually just branch out and set up Discovery Wrestling?
Well, I think, you know, at that point, you know, we'd, you know, I was going through a bit of a kind of rough patch personally, and so was Alex, you know, and we, just as mates do, we'd just meet up and have a cup of tea, and we would just talk about wrestling, we'd talk about things, and we started to get ideas about, you know, if we did our own thing, how would it be? How would it be different from others? And so it just kind of spiraled from there, from just the notion coming to one of us, oh, you know, maybe we could do something like this. And rather than try and do it in someone else's company, it's just like, let's just try it and see how it goes. You know, let's just set up a show in Edinburgh. You know, I was moving closer to Edinburgh at that point, and it was just like, let's just try and do something there, see how it works out. And if it takes off, great. If not, then at least we gave it a go. And, you know, fortunate for us, you know, the first show went down really well. And a lot of things we learned from the first show as well. But that kind of gave us the kind of catalyst to kind of move forward and think, well, we can actually do this, because it was a pretty big show that we pulled off for the first show. It shows that we can do this. If we work out a few of the kinks, if we learn the lessons from that first show, then perhaps we're on to something. And yeah, in 7 years on from when we launched, here we are.
I remember the buzz for that first show, just because of the names that you brought in. So just the two, the three big names, of course, Mike Mondo, formerly of the Spirit Squad, and Crime Time, so JTG and the late Shad Gaspard. Again, was there any particular reason why you chose these guys, or what are these guys on your first show?
They were available. we kind of reached out to there was you know, a couple of kind of wrestling agents that we knew and you know, had certain talents on their books, and so we were just in touch with, you know, the wrestling agents over in the States, and just said, you know, who would be available on these dates. And we would look into it. And they give us kind of a list of people. And Crime Time, for obvious reasons, they're Crime Time. And, you know, massive tag team, massive names. So I thought, the first show for us was just about kind of spotlight onto what we were doing. So it was like, let's kind of make this show as big as we possibly can, just so people can see we're now around and kind of what we're about. So, you know, perhaps we did overload it in the first show, but that was just to put the kind of spotlight on us. So, you know, Crime Time and Mike Mondo, because that was the kind of, you know, at that point he was kind of fresh out of Ring of Honor, and the kind of matches he was having in Ring of Honor was the kind of thing we wanted to be doing. That style of that match, that kind of main event kind of style match that they have, and he just kind of fitted what we saw as kind of wrestling and what we were wanting to kind of strive towards. So and we also had Chris Sabin on that show as well. So that was the one I was kind of most excited about, you know, being a big Motor City Machine Guns fan. I was so delighted when he took a punt on us to do our first show. And again, that was just a kind of sign of what we were trying to achieve with our wrestling, is that style again. So that was the kind of reason we brought them over. You know, I targeted Chris Sabin specifically as the person I wanted to be on that show. And then it was a case of just working with some of the agents to find out who were available and who could help put a spotlight on what we were trying to do.
We'll jump back and forth about guests and that, because there's been so many for Discovery. But like, from what I was getting from the shows, it's like for all ages, but there's a really like an indie feel to it. So you do get your likes of,
yeah.
Again, we'll speak about the Elite and what have you coming in. Was that kind of what you were aiming for, or was it just that's just how it turned out to be?
Yeah, well, we kind of set off on the idea of, you know, Generation Y. And that, you know, at that point when we were launching, that would be your 14-year-olds and over. So we were looking for that kind of that audience that you know, really appreciated the independent wrestling style. But at the same time, there were enough characters on the show that families generally could enjoy it. And it's finding that mix, because I think what you find is children will love wrestling when they go along. You know, there's always going to be good guys and there's always going to be bad guys. There's going to be people to cheer and there's going to be people to boo. But we're trying to also pull in that kind of older audience as well. And that's where that that kind of, you know, we talk about the Chris Sabins, we talk about the Mike Mondos, that's where that kind of style tried to fit in. So the people who kind of appreciate that style of wrestling would stick with us as well. So you always say that, you know, you try and offer a wrestling show for everybody. So there's a bit of everything in there for everybody. So while you might not like this match, or you might not like this person, or whatever else, you're going to like the other things on the show that's going to get you to come back. So it is a really, you know, tough kind of balancing act when you're building a card, just to kind of go, right, have we got enough elements in this that's going to keep the majority of people coming back? So that's what we try to do. And I'd like to think we've been pretty successful in keeping people coming back.
I mean, I would think so. I mean, you're still going after, well, obviously last year hasn't happened, but it's definitely still going. There's still demand for Discovery Wrestling, just from the amount of questions I got in. There's a lot of people that still want to see Disco, so to speak. So there was a little bit of a merging for a bit. You worked with Five Star Wrestling again. I'm sorry to anyone listening to this. I seem to bring them up any reason to. But you worked a bit with Five Star Wrestling, and Discovery Wrestling was actually in their PS4 game, Regenesis. How did that come about?
Yeah, well, I've known Dan beforehand. Dan Hinkles had done a game called Wrestling Manager, which was on the iPhone. That was what his company did originally, and I remember working at the radio station I was working with was in Dundee, and that's where his company was based. We actually did a news story on them because they'd been given a significant grant, and it created so many jobs locally that, you know, I thought this is a pretty cool news piece. You know, I like wrestling, and there's a bit of job creation in there. So it was actually through the day job that I met him, and, you know, we just started talking wrestling and just stayed in touch. And you know, when he decided he was going to bring out this Five Star Wrestling game, you know, and he'd spoken about doing some sort of launch, and I suggested to him, why don't you actually put on an event, you know, as a wrestling event, as a launch event for the game. And that's when, you know, I helped him with the first show that they did in Edinburgh. In Meadowbank, because it was a venue I was used to. It's an area I'm used to. You know, I know the kind of production companies locally. So I thought, you know, do this, you know, I'll help you out with the first show. And it was probably one of the most stressful things I've ever been a part of. because, you know, like Dan had just, you know, he wanted this to be as big as possible. He wanted to have this massive fan experience during the day. And it was, you know, it was much bigger than what we had done as Discovery beforehand. So it was taking on a whole load and trying to go, right, okay. So, and, you know, you had ambitions to make this the biggest thing. And fair play if you've got a dream and you try and achieve it. And so I helped them in that first that first event, and then after that they did an original tour, which I only helped with the first event, and that was me. That was enough for me. You know, I had the day job to worry about, and I had Discovery to worry about, and I didn't want to have anything else on my plate. But that was kind of my experiences of it, and that was that one show in Meadowbank in Edinburgh. You're right. With the game, he was looking to essentially just get a few different promotions on the game to kind of help, you know, spread the word of the game. And, you know, the Discovery Arena was put in there, and I think there was like three or four other promotions there. The arena's put into the game as well.
I would like to say that I've played in the arena, but I just couldn't work the game. I got up so far and I was like, I have no idea how to play this. So that was kind of the end of that chapter. I never got to wrestle in Discovery Wrestling on Five Star. But it was a quite undertaking. You say it was stressful just for the show itself, but I ended up bumping into you at WrestleZone for Aberdeen Anarchy, because you were doing yourself and Randy. You're going around promotions with testers of the game, and
they wanted to take the game on the road and just to different events, because obviously the key market is wrestling fans, isn't it? So they wanted to get people to try this game. They wanted to go to shows where perhaps there was an international name there, so they can do like a sit down chat with them as part of like this online promotional push for the game. So we ended up traveling all around the UK with this game. And again, all I'll say is it was an experience, and you know, we had a lot of fun on the road. And again, it's just things that it's experiences, you know, to looking back on it and the fun we had when we were taking the game on the road.
Right, let's get back to Discovery. So we've set up the first show, and just the second show, it was the tournament to determine the first Y Division champion. So it was Chris Sabin, Ian Ambrose, Lewis Garvin, and Damien Daniels at the time. Of course, I know why you wanted Chris Sabin in there, because of course it's Chris Sabin. Was there any reason why the other three were particularly chosen?
Their styles just suited what we were doing at that time. You know, our original plans were we were going to introduce, you know, the Y Division Championship, which we had, you know, the whole Generation Y thing, as I've said before. And then we were going to introduce a heavyweight title as well. So this, I guess the Y Division was originally seen as going to be like a junior heavyweight type title. And then there was going to be a heavyweight title. But then after bringing the Y Division Championship, which is a beautiful championship made by Paul Martin. And, you know, just when I brought in, we thought, nah, this is the championship. This is the championship for us. And by the time when we were thinking about, well, this is a more of a junior heavyweight, the styles of Lewis and Ian and Damien all worked with that. And, you know, I could see them all mixing it up with Chris Sabin, with their styles, their pace, their technical abilities, that they for me were just instantly, when I was thinking about that division, when we set it up for the first show, they were the ones who instantly came to my mind as ideal and perfect for the division. And the matches in that tournament were just outstanding.
I really liked that you did bring in like guys from my end, because it's not often they would get a chance to go down to Edinburgh or Glasgow or the Central Belt. So it was
A lot of that was working with them when I was in Dundee, and you know, I had the opportunity to wrestle at WrestleZone a couple of times in Montrose and in Aberdeen as well. So, you know, I got the chance to see them firsthand. You know, people like Ian, I've wrestled Ian on a handful of occasions. Likewise with Damien, I had a couple of matches with Damien, and then for Lewis, I'd seen Lewis at SWA or Source, it was one of the two, and he was wrestling Jonathan Gresham, and you know, myself and Randy were at that show, and we watched that match and we're just like, wow, we're blown away. We're just like, that is absolutely the kind of match we want to be putting on, you know. So for Ian and Damien, it was, I'd seen them firsthand, I've wrestled them firsthand as well, so it was a no-brainer for me to try and get them involved, because I knew how good they were, or are.
And one of the biggest feuds that really kicked off, I think, for getting Discovery Wrestling's name out there was, of course, Demo and Rampage, which, of course, is totally different from the Y Division style. But it's just two big brutes just battering each other. Again, was that just, of course, you wrestled Demo, but did you have an interaction with Rampage Brown beforehand?
I didn't know. It was just, you know, it was kind of through recommendations and people putting us in touch with people. At the time, especially when you're doing the first show and perhaps people don't really know who you are, or when you're a brand new company starting out, you know, you see so many companies kind of start out, do one show and disappear again. For the wrestlers, it takes a certain amount of trust. And, you know, fortunately, I'd known like Demo for a while. I'd known a few of the guys on the show for a while. So really through them and being able to kind of reach out to certain people like Rampage, because I'd seen Rampage online, I'd seen a lot of his matches, and he's just so impressive. So it was just like, man, I'd love to see a match between him and Demo. And then just kind of reaching out through them, you know, of course Demo knows him and set it all up through that way, and the matches they had were just, they just brought the house down.
I don't know what's happened with your mic. There's a little, I can still hear you, but there's like a crackling feedback through it. So hopefully if you're listening to this on the podcast, you can't hear it, but I can. So just in case you look at me going, he's looking a bit confused. That'll be why. It's not normally the case. So I apologize to anyone listening if that's the case, but we're still gonna have a good chat. So stay tuned. So got Rampage, got Demo, of course. It ended up going all the way to the Last Man Standing match. And then Demo's time was up not long afterwards. I think he had a match with Dave Conrad, and then he was off to NXT. So what was it like? It must be one. I think it was one of Demo's last matches before he went and became Killian Dane. Was there a reason he was in with Dave Conrad especially? Is he your next guy you wanted to move forward, or was
it just a circumstance? Yeah, it was just, I think at the time, you know, it was just like when you looked at the roster at the time, it was like, who would be capable of bringing someone the size of Demo down? And, you know, you look at the size of Dave Conrad and the strength of Dave Conrad, you know, he's the juggernaut, Dave Conrad. And at the time, it made absolute sense, you know, with what we were doing at the time, but for that to be the way for Demo to go out.
And then Dave went on to, of course, face Matt Riddle. It did pretty well from that match. The guests you have, I mean, these are the ones I just wrote down just quickly, was, of course, MVP. He had Michael Chase's last match ever. We've had Colin Castle. We had, of course, the Elite, Cody Rhodes, Bullet Club, Angelico, Mark Andrews. I mean, was there a case of were you picking the dates for shows because you can get these people in, or was it a case of you pick the dates for the shows, who can we get in?
It worked both ways. So, for example, when we had the Elite, when we had Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks, that was because they were going to be in the country. And, you know, working with a couple of the other promotions who were part of that tour for them, it was just like, well, it's this week, right? What's the date we can have? You can have a Wednesday night. And so we're putting a show especially for that, because if you're given the opportunity to have an event with the biggest independent wrestlers in the world, pretty hard to turn down. So you do what you can to make it happen and make it possible. And we'd worked with the Young Bucks before. They worked our third show that we ever did. I had the Young Bucks there in a community centre in Edinburgh, so they knew us and had a bit of trust in what we did. So it kind of works both ways at times. You know, the Bullet Club event as well, when we had Skrull and the Bucks and Cody Rhodes. Again, that was, you know, someone reaching out to us and saying, "Hey, look, we're thinking about doing a tour and this week in December. Would you guys be able to have an event for us?" We're like, we'll make it happen. Absolutely, we'll make it happen. And then other times, you know, it is, we have our schedule, and then, you know, working with other promotions in the UK to say who's in that weekend, would they be available in the state? And just working with a couple of other promotions, for example, when you mentioned Angelico, you know, he would, you know, he was around, we had him around the same time as Ricochet and Shane Strickland. They were on the same show, and they just happened to be going around a few promotions in the UK, so we were able to get them on a show. And it just sometimes it just kind of lucks out with, we got a date on that show and they happen to be in the country and they're available. And it helps as well that, you know, I'd like to think we've built up a decent reputation with people when they come in, they're treated well, they're given what they're promised, and they go away and they tell other people, hey, look, when you go to the UK, check out this promotion and see if you can get some work there. So we do have people kind of reaching out all the time. There are international wrestlers that will just message us and say, I'm going to be in the country between at the start of this month, the end of that month, do you have a show in between times? And that, yeah, that just kind of, that works.
I mean, yeah, like I say, going through these names here, like you said, with just getting them in and what have you, was there any, of course you had the Mustache Mountain and Pete Dunne, what's the collective name again? I was totally drawn a blank.
British Strong Style.
That's the one, British Strong Style. So you're due to have them, of course, but then just due to scheduling, it was not able to happen. Is there anyone that you had that fortunately couldn't happen that you regret not getting in or anything like that?
There are people who have been close to getting in and then it just hasn't happened at the last minute because their schedules changed before we could get them in. I think the last one that we were very close to was Luchasaurus. A lot of our fans were asking for Luchasaurus. So, you know, I'd reached out to see if we can make it happen. And it was just at the time that AEW were launching. And, you know, we'd been in talks and then AEW, and we had, you know, dates penciled in. And then AEW launched, and then their tapings changed the date. So ended up not being able to happen. So I was particularly gutted about that one because I knew like everybody was asking for him at that point. So who knows, man? Once shows get back up and running again, my screen froze there. Sorry if my screen froze.
So our hands disappeared for a moment, so we should be back in a second or two. Oh, that's my internet. We're having a good time here. Internet connection is now unstable.
You can see me again? Hear me again?
I can hear you now. Oh. I can hear you properly as well. Right, okay. So that's fine. We'll start again. So how did you get into it? No, I'm joking. Right.
Yeah. So does the mic sound better now than what it was?
Absolutely. Yeah. My internet was coming up with the wee internet is unstable thing. So I think my wife is watching something on Netflix, which is not helping.
Yeah. Luchasaurus was one that we were very close to bringing in. I have tried my absolute damnedest and hardest to try and get David Arquette. I'm not going to lie. He, for us, would just absolutely suit what we do. You know, throwing him in there with Moth or Gene Money or whoever else. I just, you know, we try to reach out in so many different ways. We've got people, obviously, you know, who he's interacted with in the past, like Moth and others that we've just said, look, we've tried to get in contact with them. Please put in a good word for us. You know, we don't usually beg to bring in a wrestler, but there's just something about, you know, getting involved in the David Arquette story, which would have been very, very cool. So, but I'm not sure if he's ever going to get back in the ring. We don't know if he's ever going to come across to the UK. But if he does, we'll certainly be waiting and would have a place.
That's what I like about Discovery. It really is, you take people's fans' opinions on board, because I do remember the campaign to get Discovery to a certain number of likes and you're going to try and get them a dinosaur, and that's how that all came about. I mean, you've always been very good at this kind of social media stuff, because I remember the Bring Back Mr. News campaign as well, that kind of it went a bit nuts for a little bit over my timeline anyway. Was being active on social media another thing that you were one of the putting the wrestling world to rights with Alex? Is that another thing that you kind of thought of in Discovery?
No, I'm not entirely sure. We obviously, you know, we're so heavily reliant on social media when it comes to promoting what we do. And I don't know if it was trying to change anything about the way people use social media or anything like that. It was just, it's just whatever comes naturally to you, like for when you're putting up posts or when you're tweeting things out. I actually think we could actually be a lot better at it than what we are. And a lot of people have told us, you know, a lot of people from, certainly from an industry standpoint, have told us about, our presence on Twitter, for example, that we don't use it well. And that's probably why a lot of people still don't really know what Discovery is or what Discovery is about, because for everything that we've achieved at events and shows, we don't really sell ourselves that well. So perhaps we're not the best when it comes to social media. You know, you look at other companies that are just doing great work when it comes to social media that you know they're around all the time, even when there's no shows. Whereas us, you know, I'm perhaps not the best. Maybe I need to just get someone to kind of, maybe some sort of social media guru on board just to do it for us.
I guess the hard thing, I mean, at least for as a promotion, I mean, I find it difficult, and I'm just a podcast page, to try and like gauge interest, because some folk will just like it, so they see the whatever podcast, whatever else comes up. They're not that fussed about me particularly. So if I set up and watch something on the network and tweet about it, they don't care. They just want to know who I'm speaking to next and what questions I'm going to ask or they can ask, or what about dinosaurs and all that rubbish. But when I was saying this about social media, it's because when I put out that I was having you on the show, I tagged just a bunch of names of previous people
I saw. Yeah.
And of course I was like, very rarely do any of the bigger names like it or retweet it. And then suddenly I had Chris Sabin, I had Damo, I had all these people going, I was like, oh, well, Alan must have done something very well if these guys are actually taking the time to go, all right, I'll keep an eye on what's happening. So you must treat your staff well.
Yeah, I think you have to. I think people, because we're not a massive company. We're a small independent wrestling company, and we're relying on reputation for when it comes to people wanting to see our shows and for when it comes to people wanting to work our shows, reputation. And you know, and if you treat people well, they want to do more for you. You know, they want to promote what you do. So you know, if I was horrible with people or didn't give them what I promised, or they would never promote what we do, and perhaps they wouldn't want to take the bookings with us. So you have to treat people well, because at the end of the day, you know, the wrestlers are going out and putting on the show are the ones who are bringing the fans in for us. So treat them well, treat them with respect, and hopefully that kind of comes back as what you say. You know, there's, you know, with the likes of Damo or Chris Sabin kind of sharing that we're doing this podcast, they don't have to do that. But clearly they enjoyed their time with us and want us to do well.
Okay. Okay, we'll let's dot in about Discovery Wrestling, the shows itself, but you end up on Fight TV for a bit, for a little bit. Again, how did that come about?
Well, again, it was just, we're just building that reputation. I think at that point we put on a couple of those bigger events at the Corn Exchange with some of the names you mentioned. And I think that caught some attention just because of who were on the shows. So we just entered into a discussion with them about possibly going to do some streaming with them. We put up a few kind of highlight type shows just to kind of try and get the ball rolling, maybe try and bring in an audience with Fight. And again, as I was saying about the social media side, we don't really sell ourselves the best. You know, we put on really great shows. We've just got like such a great roster. We put on really good shows, but I think, you know, as Disco, we don't really sell ourselves. We don't really push ourselves hard. And so I think the thing with Fight is I wasn't really pushing as hard as I should have. But there's going to be other opportunities coming up around the corner, which I'm kind of tight-lipped at the moment about. We'll have a couple of big announcements to make when we announce our comeback. So there'll be more to come on that.
Yeah, I did catch some of the shows. Unfortunately, it's like, it's just finding time. That's the only thing. When it comes to streaming, it's very difficult to find a moment. And because Fight TV if it's not on YouTube or WWE Network, I'm not going to really have a time to sit down and watch it on the TV. I don't have Chromecast or any of that stuff like that. So instead of looking at any screen or nothing.
Yeah, and for me as well, that you know, as I've said, we're a small team. You know, I do a lot of work when it comes to kind of pulling the shows together, and I was also trying to pull together these online shows as well as doing everything else, as well as doing the day job, and perhaps taking on too much and not being able to keep up with the regular schedule of getting these shows up online. So, you know, when we are coming back, we've got a team in place now who are going to take a lot of the weight off my shoulders, take a lot of the work away from me so I can focus on what I want to focus on. So things will be, you know, things will be slightly different when we come back, but there certainly will be announcements to come about, you know, the likes of streaming and things for Disco.
Have you had any particular favourite, like, storylines throughout Disco? I mean, I know we've had things like Joe Hendry and his son looking sharp, and they end up against Tommy Dreamer and Grado, as an example. But is there any particular highlights that you've enjoyed the most being come to fruition?
I liked the return of Andy Wilde. I felt like that worked out really well because he'd reached out. I think he just had a WWE tryout, and he reached out to me and said, you know, he wanted to, he'd kind of been part of what we'd done just here and there, because a lot of our shows kind of coincided with whether it be his day job or whatever else. And there was a lot of shows he couldn't make, so we couldn't get like a proper run with him. It was kind of like stop start. So he reached out to me and asked about, because he'd seen what other people, the kind of matches that Joe Hendry, the kind of matches that Joe Coffey were having in Disco, and, you know, was kind of looking for that same sort of build and that same sort of match. So, you know, we worked out a plan with Andy to come back, and it was the Disco Derby. That was the first time we had a Disco Derby, which is our rumble, you know, over the top rope until you get to the final two, where the winner got a place back on the roster, and that's where it started for him. So I liked that story in the way that, you know, he came back after an absence, won that, got his place back on the roster. And for the next year, it was just build, Andy. You know, put him in with, you know, Zach Gibson, put him in with Eddie Dennis, put him in with these, you know, big UK names to try and keep building this Andy Wilde momentum and story until we finally got to, it was pretty much exactly a year after he won the Disco Derby, where he got to have a wide division match with Joe Coffey. And, you know, the crowd reaction was just unbelievable. You know, for the first 5, 6, 7 minutes of that match, they just stood still, and the crowd were just dueling chants for like ages. They didn't have to do anything but stand and just look at each other, and the crowd were just going bananas. So that, to me, felt like that had worked, because we built up to that point where we had such a reaction. So it was, you know, that for me was pretty cool. There's lots of other kind of things that worked well for us. Mundertaker was sometimes I have just really stupid ideas, and 99% of the time I don't act on them. 1% of the time I do. And this one all stemmed from, we had the world's first ever proper death match. And a lot of people have death matches in wrestling and nobody ever dies. And we decided to have a death match where someone would die, because we surrounded the ring with zombies. And the objective of the match was to throw your opponent out the ring to be eaten by zombies, and they would die. And the world's first ever proper death match, a match that we called Survival. And that was inspired because my pal Jamie, who is my best pal and he's a graphic designer, had created this image. I said, look, we're going to do a Halloween show, and can you come up with some kind of striking poster, maybe zombie inspired? And he came up with this really gritty kind of movie looking graphic of like an empty ring with bloodstains in a warehouse surrounded by zombies. And as soon as he showed me that graphic, I went, man, wouldn't it be cool if we had a match where the ring was surrounded by zombies? And one thing led to another, and I spoke to Gene Money about it. I spoke to Sugar Dunkerton about it. They just struck me as the right folk for being in that match. And so it worked. The match, like I remember just standing in the sound booth, watching this match unfold before my eyes, of seeing a ring surrounded by zombies and someone trying to kill someone, and thinking, I'm troubled because this was in my head and now it's actually happening out there, exactly how I pictured it in my head. And from then on, because we killed Gene Money, he was eaten by a zombie, I then had the idea of how we bring Gene Money back, and we just thought Mundertaker. And he was fully on board with it, and he did the best Undertaker parody I've ever seen. And we'll have to say it was a parody. He wasn't copying him. It was a parody. And it was just tremendous. And then he had this full year of being the Mundertaker, and the fans just went bananas for it. You know, the Mundertaker chants were great. You had a match with Session Moth where they did the Taker Brock Lesnar sit up moment, laughing at each other, which I popped huge for. So yeah, that was another kind of proud moment for me, was, you know, seeing this, you know, survival zombie match happen, and then the resulting year with the Undertaker.
For those things, you've spent at that point maybe 4 or 5 years building the trust of the fans. So if you pull out something a bit out there, they trust you to not insult their intelligence. It's gonna work. Just trust us. It's gonna work.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of what we do out there, you know, as I was talking about, you know, having something for everybody out there, and having the layers of a wrestling event, you know, some things are kind of tongue in cheek, and you need to have room for a lot of fun on a show as well, you know. And if you have that kind of the light and shade of an event where you can have a match where it's just like, it is fun, but you need people who can actually pull it off to make it work. And then you can follow up with a kind of serious, kind of heavyweight, kind of main event style match. And it seems to work for us, how we kind of structure things. So I'd like to think it works for us, and having those moments where we could say, hey guys, look, we're going to have a match where the ring is going to be surrounded by zombies, and people go, oh yeah, no, I'm up for that. Yeah, that's cool. That's not stupid at all.
And then you bring it all back full circle with Sugar Dunkerton putting his soul on the line. Against the Undertaker.
And he lost his soul. So Sugar Dunkerton lost his soul. So he then lost his ability to be cool, and he lost his ability to dance, and he lost everything about himself. So then he had the opportunity to win it back in a steel cage. You know, Discovery's first ever steel cage match was a match for Sugar Dunkerton's soul.
Wrestling's great. Just,
yeah.
When you put it out like that, it's just amazing.
Yeah, this is why I enjoy it, because, you know, because we're kind of in tune with what our fans want, you know, and that's, I'm never really fast for what kind of goes on elsewhere. You know, I don't really follow a lot these days, but you know, when it's just, when you have that connection with the fans and you know what they're into, you know what they like, and you listen to what they actually want, and then it when it works out like that and everybody just has a good time. And for me, the kind of buzz of it all is when, you know, after the show, you know, people have had a good time with the reaction they're giving the matches. But see, when people are going home and they're tweeting and they're tagging, or they're posting on Facebook just talking about what a great time they had, what a great show, and they're posting photos of them with the wrestlers. That for me is the kind of biggest buzz of it, knowing that you've put on this show that people have just really, really enjoyed. Bigger buzz doing that than any wrestling match I ever had.
Has there been any guests particularly that you were surprised at the reception they received, like a Chris Wolf or a Tony Storm, just someone that you brought in thinking, oh, this will be quite good, but I don't know how our fans will take it, and they end up just exploding, blowing out the expectations?
I don't think so. I think everyone that we brought in has delivered for us. And most of the time we're bringing people in based on what the fans want anyway. So, you know, people keep tagging us, we want to see this wrestler, I want to see that wrestler. And then we do bring them in. It just works. Everybody, you know, our fans are just of course, every promoter is going to say their fans are the best, but our fans are the best, and they just take it all in and they just enjoy everything that's put on in front of them.
Again, it's that give and take thing. You listen and you provide, and they go, right, okay, cool, that's fine. We'll trust you, and we do things like survival. Then we'll just take it as it is. I want to turn
survival into a proper thing. I want to turn survival, and you know, we've had these discussions in the Disco creative team about, you know, what we could possibly do during lockdown while there's no events happening, and the one thing I wanted to do, and we're not going to do it just now, it might be something that can happen in future, but I want to turn survival into a real life feature. I want to have a proper warehouse. I want to make it like a, you know, these cinematic type matches that WWE have. I want to have that, but with survival. And maybe if David Arquette ever wants to come to Scotland, we could do a survival sequel, and he could be in it, and it would just that would be me. I would be, my life would be complete. I'd be spent. And that'd be fine.
Have you ever had? I mean, I know you had a couple matches here and there for storyline purposes. Well, I think one. I've had one match for storyline purposes. But is there any inkling or wanting to wrestle in Discovery yourself? Or are you quite happy just being behind the curtain now?
No, if anybody backstage ever sees me at a disco show, that they'll see me running laps around the place, because I'm trying to do too much, and I'm kind of running from there to here to there to here, and I'm knackered. I'm absolutely knackered come the end of the show, that the thought of actually doing a match while trying to run the show, I had that one match, which was on the, we had a show where the matches were all decided by raffle, and the raffle number I got drawn was actually my number, so I had to wrestle a match, and I only played a small part in that match, but that was enough for me to kind of go, yeah, I'm well and truly over this. I don't need to do this in ring stuff anymore. You know, I had fun when I was doing it, and I'll just stick to staying behind the curtain and doing what I'm better at doing.
Well, just before your career was up, though, you end up in a very interesting period as the Reckless Intent Hardcore Champion.
The greatest Reckless Intent Hardcore Champion of all time. I believe I'm a 5-time Reckless Intent Hardcore Champion, or so Cage Match says.
Our records possibly say that as well, because I do a lot of research, because during like show days of Discovery, all these videos would pop up of title defences, or actually not even defences, title losses throughout the day. So we've had things like Will Ospreay as a former Reckless Intent Hardcore Champion, Doug Williams, Darren T. Goss as a former champion. Again, was that just Reckless Intent must put a bit of trust in you that you were going to do these things, or how did you end up with that happening?
Well, the guys at Reckless at the time I'd say they were bringing back a 24/7 title, and it's just people spitballing ideas, you know, and just saying, would it, for a bit of social media content, wouldn't it be fun if we did this? And just it's for the fans to kind of watch something and enjoy something, you know. There's no real meaning behind any of it. It's just, let's just have a bit of fun, because that's what we want to do, and provide people with a bit of fun and entertainment. And they had this idea of, you know, I think it was a weekend when we did have, you know, a couple of big guests coming in, and they thought, wouldn't it be funny if we could have them listed as a former Reckless Intent Hardcore Champion? You know, it would be pretty cool for the company to have them listed as a former champion, and we could film something fun for social media at the same time. So we just went with it. I think I lost to Will Ospreay, because he wrote on a bit of paper, "I quit." And he just showed me the bit of paper and said, "What does that say?" And I said, "I quit." And he went, took the title, and went, "Thanks very much." I lost the title in a dream to Yuji Maki, won the championship for me in a dream. I won the championship from Doug Williams. I traded him a beer for it. So we did have a lot of fun. That's essentially what it is. It's just enjoying it and putting stuff out there for other people to enjoy.
Yeah, well, one of my favourite ones was Darren T. Goss tapping out a handshake to Doug Williams. That was a favourite. So when you brought on, you had your commentary team, of course, which is Randy Valentine and the international broadcast analyst himself, Darren Teagos. Was it just an inspired choice with these guys I trust with selling the show, or was there any further thought put into having them to call in the show?
Yeah, well, knowing them both and knowing one just how clued up they both are in terms of like for example, Darren's got this encyclopedic knowledge of wrestling. Randy's great at just calling action, and I'd heard before Discovery launched, I'd heard Randy commentate on a match before, and so when we're launching Discovery, actually Darren and myself hadn't spoken for a long time before that. You know, we kind of lost communication for a while, and when I was thinking about a commentary team, and instantly Randy was the first one that came to my mind, and I thought who would be great to be paired up with him, and then Darren, not long after, came to my mind and thought, you know, one, he's got a great voice. You know, I love the Welsh accent. And two, his encyclopedic knowledge of wrestling is just unbelievable. And I thought, he's just perfect. You know, Darren is just perfect. And I needed to reach out to him. And, you know, we started talking again, which was great. And he's, you know, he's now one of my best friends. And he has been for many years. And it was just trial and see how we go. And the first time I heard them commentate together, I thought, we're on to something with these guys, because they complement each other so well. You know, they know when to call the action, they know when to tell the story, and they know when they can have a bit of fun. And it's important, because, you know, you see that a lot. Some people maybe have commentators that are just having fun constantly. They're not calling the action, they're not calling the story, they're not getting over what's actually happening, because they're so focused on, I've got to entertain. But Randy and Darren just seem to know when they can have a lighter moment. They seem to know when they need to call the action and tell the story. So, you know, I'm really fortunate to have met them both, and that both two of my best friends, and they're just superb commentary team.
They really compliment each other. I mean, as high praise, they're a very brain and gorilla chemistry. Because just one, of course, Darren would be just rooting for the bad guys, of course, and then Randy would be like, will you stop, and all that kind of stuff. So it very, very well suited for each other. As far as gimmicks, you mentioned Disco Derby, the Zombie Survival. You brought in on Civil War, the tag team tournament, and of course Hotter Than Hell, the Horror in Hell tournament as well. Again, was you just all spitballing ideas to see what would work?
Yeah, it's just trying to come up with ideas that are slightly different. I mean, on Civil War, we only did the 1 year because I wanted to do something different for tag teams. I wanted to have it as a yearly tournament where at the end of the year, you know, the tag team gets a trophy, and they're known as, for example, the 2017 Tag Team Champions. And then the following year, we'll have on Civil War again, and whoever wins that, they would be known as the 2018 Tag Team Champions. So they're tag team champions for a year, essentially. But we did that, and it perhaps didn't get the greatest response. People were like, we just want belts. And I was just like, okay. You know, because sometimes we'll try stuff to be a bit different and not just follow the same formula that everybody else does. Because you want to stand out a wee bit more. So it's just like, you know, everybody else has a briefcase that can run in and cash any other time. Let's not do that. You know, let's try and do something different. You know, so we did, you know, the Hotter Than Hell tournament, which was based on, we were working closely with a local tattoo studio called the Hotter Than Hell Tattoo Studios. Jeff Cole, who's the owner there, is one hell of a guy. He's appeared in a lot of disco videos, and a big American rock and roller. And he, you know, so I thought, like, I like the name Hotter Than Hell. And I thought, we'll do a tournament, and the winner of the tournament gets a title match, essentially. They become the number one contender. They pick the date. It's not like a run-in cash, and they can just pick the date and when they're going to have that match. So again, it's just trying things that are different, and not everything will work. Not everything will pay off and get you the response you're hoping for. Like on Civil War, for example, I mean, the matches were great. The tag team matches were great. And on Civil War, the four-way tag final, you know, it was that. It was just chaos. And I like a bit of chaos now and then. But it's just trying things slightly differently, like the Disco Derby. You know, every company has its own version of a rumble, their own names for rumbles, same sort of thing, over the top rope. So I thought, what kind of twist can we do on a Rumble? And it was like, right, okay, when we get down to the final two, it becomes a one-on-one match. And then you've got these two people who should be exhausted from being in this over-the-top rope thing for ages. And then you get to the final two and they're just exhausted one-on-one match. And then, you know, traditional one-on-one match rules there. So we've done a couple of the disco derbies, and I think they work really well. I like them. I think everybody loves a Rumble. Certainly, you know, growing up, the Royal Rumble was always my favourite event as a kid. Even to this day, I don't watch masses of wrestling these days, but I'll always make time for the Royal Rumble. It's just for us, it's just trying to think of how can we do things differently, slightly differently, make things a bit more unique to what we do. And I don't think anyone else has had a zombie lumberjack match yet, so I think we're the first in that one.
There's just like a fine line when it comes to doing these kind of things, though. So it could be really great, or it could be like TNA, Russo levels of weirdness. You've kind of skirted that line very finely, but it works. It still worked. Was am I right in thinking when I saw the poster for Disco Derby, it was supposed to be 2020? Was it going to be mixed, or was it too?
Yeah. We were just going to have, you know, barrier. Gender is no barrier for the Disco Derby, and it was just going to be. Everyone's involved, you know, everyone's welcome to take part in the Disco Derby, and that was what it was going to be last year. So unfortunately it didn't happen. That was going to be the last event. That would have been our last event, but because of the pandemic, obviously, everything's had to be put on hold until we come back. So we're probably, the Disco Derby will probably not happen again until next year, I would imagine. But we're probably run it the same way we were going to run it last year.
And I was seeing that. I don't know if you just kind of just told anyone who had their poster, but I just put it out because I saw Omar Muhammad. I saw a bunch of names. I was like, oh, that would have been great to see him in there.
Yeah, I felt really bad for a lot of the guys because, you know, a lot of the people involved, it would have been their first appearance with us. And I think the likes of a derby is good to give the fans an introduction to some folk that they've never seen before. So like Omar, really charismatic guy, you know, we're looking forward to having him in there and a whole load of others. There's quite a lot of people that were due to make their first appearances with us. So when we do come back, you know, I'm going to try and certainly, you know, keep my promises with people and say, you know, you were promised a spot, you know, when the Disco Derby does happen, we'll try and have the people we were going to have in there.
Right. So we're jump into some of these fan questions because, like I said, I had loads, so we'll try and get through some of them. So I've got a couple one about raffles, so we'll get them out of the way. So we've got Stephen Louch with, will raffles be affected by any COVID restrictions?
Oh, I don't know. I haven't thought that far ahead about how does COVID affect a raffle. Is there issues with handling tickets and handing tickets over? Will I need to get Julian and everyone else to wear gloves when they're doing the raffle? Will I need to put hand sanitizer on their hands every single time they sell a ticket? Otherwise, it's going to be a very, very long night selling tickets. A lot of these things will have to come into consideration, but hopefully the raffle can happen as normal.
And on that subject, Brent Carter's asked, what colour is it? I'm assuming that's the raffle.
I hope so. This has always been one of these weird things, that people kind of latch onto at shows before you know it becomes a thing. And we were always just selling white raffle tickets. You know, it was just, you know, all the tickets were white. It was just a white raffle ticket book that we bought, and it was just like, right, okay. So at one show, one of the fans just shouted out when I pulled the ticket. They knew the tickets were the same colour, but someone just shouted, what colour is it? And I said, well, it's white, and everybody cheered. So then every time I was pulling a ticket, everyone then would shout, what colour is it? And I would have to say, it's white, and people would cheer. So it's just become a thing now where, you know, you're drawing the raffle and people ask what colour the ticket is, and they go bonkers when you tell them what the colour of the ticket is. It's again that for me is disco. You know, that's what, you know, the fans absolutely just have a ball, and it's just a blast.
And that's one of the weirdest things that that the fans have latched onto for stuff. Just go, why it's a raffle ticket? How have you found a way to do this?
Yeah, these things just seem to happen. And the other thing that happens, which, you know, we'll maybe try and avoid when we come back, is when we do the safety announcements at the start, you know, because, you know, it is a PG crowd, there's a family crowd, we tell people not to swear when they're chanting and things. And, you know, when we're doing the safety announcements and we tell the fans there are kids present, fans boo. So, like, we're saying there are children present and then everybody just boos. And I'll say, no, there are kids here. And then they boo again. And so we're going to turn that around when we come back. I want, when we come back and we see their families here and their kids here, I want people to cheer and go, it's great, you know, that the fans are here. Because it is serious. We don't want kids going away not having a great time. We don't want kids going away thinking they've been booed by every other fan. So we're going to try and turn that on its head when we come back.
So we've got Alan at Big F and Tree. I have no reason to put his handle in. I just love it. I think it's just a great handle. He's put, when will we be getting All About the Raffle 2 Electric Boogaloo?
I actually love the All About the Raffle event because, again, people love surprises. And, you know, other companies have got their events where they have a kind of an unannounced card. You know, I think Progress is unboxing they have, and other companies have kind of similar types of events where nothing's announced in advance and things are all surprised. And because fans are so hot on a raffle, that we just decided to base a whole event around a raffle where the matches would be decided by, we'll draw a number, oh, whose number is this? Well, here's their music and here they come. So nobody knew who was on the cards. Nobody knew what the matches were. So everything was completely unannounced. And I actually had a lot of fun doing it, and it's definitely going to be a feature when we come back. I think that's now going to be one of our staple events of the year. Is going to be All About the Raffle.
And speaking of that, because of that match, yourself and Randy, tag match, Shady Natras, who's, I've said it, I'm sure I've said his surname wrong, and I've interviewed him, which makes it worse. He's just put, what do you think about the fact that he's taking credit for you losing your last match in Discovery Wrestling? He's pretty sure that should have awarded him a title shot when the shows return.
Well, I don't know if beating a kind of 5-stone overweight promoter hasn't wrestled in years is really a sign of championship material, if you know what I mean. I'm pretty sure 99% of the Disco roster could beat me within minutes. So I think he might still have a bit more hard work to do to show himself to be championship worthy. He's not going to take too well to that comment. I know that for a fact. So let's just see what happens when we come back and see what we've got in store for Shady.
I'm just more curious of who the 1% is. He could have a go at beating, but we'll move on. Lewis Chapman, we kind of covered his question, but we'll kind of expand on it, I think, or you may not. You may just listen to it and go, no, that's fine, I've answered it. Are there any names that you wanted to bring to Discovery Wrestling but haven't managed to as of yet, which we kind of covered? If so, yep. Are there any plans to do so? So is there a chance we might get a dinosaur?
Well, we'll see what happens in future. I mean, I think on a serious note for when we come back, I think, you know, this idea of having, you know, people from overseas coming in for events, it's not going to be a feature for a while going forward, obviously with restrictions and there's so many uncertainties when it comes to international travel. So I think even when shows return and things ease up a bit, there's always going to be uncertainty when it comes to the international. So it could be quite a way along down the line before we do that again. So I don't want to get anyone's hopes up, but I know David Arquette listens to the podcast. So if he just wants to drop me a line, I'm sure we can make a special arrangement for him to get into the country.
I love the confidence that David Arquette listens to this. And I'm going to tag him in this. I'm going to make sure that he definitely knows that he's wanted, especially in Edinburgh. I kind of answered TRK's question. He put in a couple, but one that kind of piggybacks off that one was, with current travel restrictions, will there be a focus on bringing in talent from the rest of the UK or stick with Scottish stars for now?
Well, I think we've got a really kind of strong kind of core group within Scotland that we use and that are part of the roster. And, you know, we tend to bring in maybe just a handful of wrestlers from outside of Scotland to be part of the show. So I think we've already got like a really strong core roster. I think there will be changes when we come back. Other people I want to give opportunities to who've not had any opportunities over the past year. They've not had an opportunity to do any sort of events over the past year. So there are certainly people I want to give a chance to and give a real good push to and hopefully help them out in some way, kind of get to where they're trying to go. There's just such a strong talent pool within Scotland. So I think we're very fortunate to be in the position we're in.
Absolutely. Well, 5 million people in this country, we've probably got one of the strongest independent wrestling scenes. I mean, I could be biased because I have a website about it, but I would say we do. Right, so TRK, he's asked a bunch, so let's go through them. Will Discovery ever venture outside Edinburgh?
I can't see it. Edinburgh for us was where we wanted to start off and start to be, because there's obviously other companies that kind of run in Edinburgh, but we wanted to base ourselves in Edinburgh and just see if we can help build a scene within Edinburgh. And it's just where I am these days. And I don't think there's a demand for us to kind of come out of Edinburgh. There's not another city that are kind of desperate to see us come to their city. So our audience is in Edinburgh, around Edinburgh. That's where we're based. And I've got no desire. We're not a touring company. We're very much Edinburgh's wrestling company.
And he's also asked, do Discovery have a new home with the Jam House closure?
Yeah, that was gutting. The Jam House was such a perfect venue for us. The size, the setup, the layout. I just stumbled upon the venue one day and noticed they had done an MMA event, and I noticed that I'd never had wrestling before. So just inquired, and before we know it, we're in the Jam House umpteen times a year, and it became our home. And it's just such a perfect venue for, like, you know, where the crowd is and the atmosphere it gives, and everybody who wrestled there loved being in there. And, you know, I think it was kind of towards August time they just announced they were closing, and there doesn't seem to be any moves for anybody to take it over. It's not on the market. It's not. So we don't know what's happening with the venue. We don't know if there's going to be other owners, other people move in, or if they would have us, or what they would do with it if they move in. And that's one of Edinburgh's biggest problems, is just the lack of good venues for like the size of shows we do. We had Portobello Town Hall before, which had to close because of structural issues, and that's still closed. And then we have Edinburgh Corn Exchange, which is at the other scale of things. It's just a massive venue, and it's just the biggest venue that we do, and so it's not one that we would use regularly. And then the Jam House, which kind of became our home, so we're without that at the moment. And that's one of the difficulties just now in terms of planning the comeback, is just trying to find good venues in Edinburgh that are the right size for us. And the search continues. I'm still in talks with a lot of different venues. So we'll see what happens when we come back.
So with the Portobello Town Hall, is that just because you blew the roof off it a couple of times? Is that the structural issues there?
Yeah, absolutely. It was our fault. No, we will not take responsibility for that. So I think the repair bill is about £1 million or something. So, I don't have that in the back pocket.
And he's just finally asked, we'll just get this one in. Has anyone said you look like the guy asking Nicola Sturgeon questions on the telly?
I get that a lot, actually. I don't know where that comes from, but yeah. That's essentially been my year for the past year, is just sitting in my home office working from here and trying to ask people the right questions, I guess.
So we kind of answered Craig Gordon's question, which was, what's the earliest date for a show in Edinburgh for Discovery? Let's find a venue first.
We're in talks with a few venues. So it's just now waiting for the restrictions, and you know, we're not going to plan or announce or confirm anything until we absolutely get the green light, when Scotland's in a much safer, better place, and we're told, yeah, it's absolutely safe to do and there's no issues in doing it. That's got to be the first priority for everybody. It's like there's bigger things happening right now than wrestling. As much as we all love wrestling, there's other things, you know, that need to be taken care of first. And once it's been taken care of, and once we get the green light, and when we're told you could do a show and it's going to be viable and it can work, then we'll get things confirmed and get things moving.
Ashley Vega just put Ashley versus Session Moth. So I think that's a match request for when shows return.
Possibly, if you know, if the fans want to see it, we can clearly make it happen, you know.
Johnny Lamb with, are you buying the Ultimate Edition Stone Cold Steve Austin, you grippy git?
one of the things over the past year is I got back into collecting figures, which I've not done in years. Because I knew I was spending a lot of time in this office over the last year, I just wanted to get my toys out, essentially. So I looked out a whole load of figures from the attic, and I've kind of placed them out. I can't really show you them just now, but I've got a lot of figures out, and I started collecting and buying some more figures, which I haven't done in years. So, and because Johnny's a massive collector, and he knows which ones you need to get, so he's constantly saying, get this one, get that one, get this one. But I've told him I've run out of shelf space, and I just don't have room for any more. I don't have many out, but I do not have room for any more. And every now and then there's a figure that pops up that he's like pushing really hard for me to get. In fact, the last one I got, I'm about to knock my entire shelf over here. The last figure I bought was this Mr. T. First in the line Mr. T figure. The box is just so cool that I just had to get the Mr. T figure. And that was the last figure I bought. And I told him that was the last one I'm going to buy until something stupidly special comes along.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the exact same. This wall behind me, wrong hand. You couldn't see me doing it anyway. This wall behind me, I had 4 Funko Pops when this lockdown started. I had 4 WWE ones, and it's a bit wild. Since
you've now got a tower.
I've done a little bit of. They used to just all be down the side, but I thought, oh, it's a bit too. Look at them. I thought I'll put them behind me instead, but no, it's gotten a bit out of control. Downstairs is worse because my wife's gotten into them as well. So I've got Forrest Gump and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, goodness. I've only got a handful of Funkos. I've got an Axl Rose. I've got a Freddy Krueger, 8-bit Freddy Krueger, which was a present from Darren T. Goss. Get well soon, Darren. I've got a mini Jack Skellington. I've got Punisher.
Oh.
I've got an Ultimate Warrior, and I've got a Kenny Omega Funko Pop. So that's my line.
I do have a figure. I got a Drew because it was in B&M for like £8. I was like, I can't not buy that because it's Drew. Gotta buy that. So I think that's all the fan questions. I've got my 2 stupid questions that we'll put in. We've mentioned dinosaurs quite often in this, but what's your favourite dinosaur?
It has to be I would say a Velociraptor. I don't know why. I just like the Velociraptors from watching Jurassic World. That was it, you know. Let's go with that. Although I really like I'm rubbish with dinosaur names. The original Jurassic Park, the little dinosaur that spits in the fella's face.
I just played Jurassic World Lego
not long ago. It pops up. And he thinks it's all been really cute, and all of a sudden it pops up its it's like whatever it is, it's the skin around its neck, it pops up like this, and then it just spits at him. I think that's a pretty cool little dinosaur.
Yeah.
Let's go with the spitting dinosaur.
We'll go with that spitting dinosaur. And another question that we ask people is, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Oh, man.
We ask the big questions here.
And it's sheep, it's not rams.
Now Joe Henry had an argument with me about this because I said two sheep versus one cow and I brought up rams. It's open to your own interpretation. So if the cow could be a Highland cow, it can be
just
any breed of cow versus any two breed of sheep. It doesn't matter what they are. That's your thought from there.
If it was rams, if it was a couple of rams, I'd go for them. Because cows don't come over as being very aggressive and they look like they would just stand there and take it until they were done. Whereas the rams would just keep going and going and going. So if it was a couple of rams, I would put my money on them.
Great. That's why sheep are starting to pull ahead now. A lot of people went for cow just because of size. But Joe brought up the fight about the two sheep and one cow going, no, you said sheep, not rams. That's your choice. You can decide from there.
Even if it was sheep and not rams, I would stick with the sheep. Two sheep over one cow.
Exactly. It's numbers. It's a number game. So back to Discovery stuff. Of course, Chris Sabin, first champion. Right back to the start. Chris Sabin was your first champion, but had to give up the belt due to injury. What were your thoughts going into that? Did you already have a kind of backup plan in place when he relinquished it? Or
nope. Yeah, absolutely not. No. Obviously, you know, we had plans to bring him over again and again and again. He was going to be regular with us. But then he had that really, really bad knee injury that kept him out for well over a year. And so we had to come up with a backup plan. You know, we'd created a kind of interim champion in the meantime with the hope that one day possibly Sabin could come back and then we could have the champions face off. So interim became Lewis Gervin, and he was interim for maybe about a year. And we thought, well, it's now been like 2 years since we've seen Sabin and Lewis has been interim for a year, so we might as well just make it official that he's the champion, you know. And we're still in contact with Chris Sabin a lot, and we do hope that once we're in a position where, you know, international travel is a bit more secure and people can start coming back, that he will definitely be on the top of my list. I did say David Arquette, but you know, in a serious note, you know, if we had the opportunity, number one on my list would be to bring Chris Sabin back. It's great to see him back wrestling again. And we'd love for him to come back and have his crack at getting his championship back.
And we'll kind of leave on a hypothetical before we do all the social media bits. You have enough money to book Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Mm.
That's it. That's all the people you can get though. Who out of the Discovery Wrestling roster would you have him face, other than yourself, just for the moment?
Oh dear. Who would he face? That's a rough question. Because I'll be accused of playing favourites.
I'm just imagining everyone from Discovery want your core roster just going, just leaning forward a little bit, going.
Yeah. Yeah. who's he gonna say? Who would he mix it up with? Let's see. Oh, that's a really tough question. You had to finish with this one, didn't you?
I had to go for that. Well, I should have said, and finally, harken back to your finishing move. Damn. I'll put it in a sec, it's fine. I'll edit it. But yeah, that's a big tough question that I'm finishing with.
Yeah, do you know what? I think a match between him and Joe Hendry. Clearly, I'm saying that. The promos. And I'd love to see what Joe Henry would do as an entrance to Stone Cold. So that for me, let's stick with, because he's the champ and he's the guy in the spotlight for us, and the promos and what the possible entrance could be, let's go with Joe Henry.
Oh man, just the actual thought of that. You'd have yourself a special guest ref though, just to be there, right?
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I would be the guy throwing the beers at the end of the match.
That's where I'll hammer. Just do a bit of both. Right. So thank you for being on the show. I kept you for an hour and a half. So I think that's you're that busy with real world stuff. I think an hour.
This is enough time. Billy. You know, this has been awesome for me because you know, I like everybody else has really missed wrestling over the shows. You know, anytime someone gives me the opportunity to talk disco, I will talk disco for hours, and it's such a welcome break from everything else that's going on just now. So I appreciate you taking the time to speak with me and asking me on, and I think Scottish Wrestling appreciates what you do for Scottish Wrestling and giving people the platform who otherwise wouldn't get the platform to get the names out there and to get the personalities out there. So I should be thanking you.
Thank you. I'll take all the thanks I can get. And finally, where can people find you on social media?
Not me personally. I'm not a massive social media guy. But for Discovery Wrestling on Twitter, you can find us at Disco Wrestling, which is essentially where all the Disco Wrestling chants came from. It's because there's not enough characters in the Twitter handle to create Discovery Wrestling, so I had to shorten it to Disco Wrestling. And that has become our affectionate nickname. We are Disco Wrestling, so at Disco Wrestling. On Facebook, it's / Discovery Wrestling. And on Instagram, now I'm not the Instagram guy, and I may get this wrong, and if I do, Darren Goss is going to slap me down. But I'm pretty sure on Instagram we're Discovery_Wrestling. I could be wrong. And if I am, I'm apologising in advance to Darren, especially.
You know what, just to save face, just in case, I don't want you to get slapped by your international broadcast analyst. it's Discovery_Wrestling, you're correct. So, there you go.
Hey, there you go. I'm not a social media guy, but I know my handles.
Perfect, well, thank you for joining me today.
Cheers.